simple, primarily voice. And because of the vintage vibe, I'm going to start with vintage recordings. And it's interesting because it's Harry Belafonte. And I think this one was done in 1956, so it's the same vintage as I am, coincidentally.
I have one quick question, if you don't mind. What do you tell people about how far back they should sit from the speaker? Ideally, I know that it varies depending on your what kind of music you're like, what perspective you like, but what were you thinking when you set?
So when you're doing a concentric driver, the distance becomes much less critical because they're always integrated together.
Okay.
When you get closer to a speaker that's got spaced drivers.
Yeah, they don't integrate.
They don't integrate. You get a slight change in balance if you get too close, your proximity effect, but otherwise, it sort of doesn't matter. What you get is the same sound character, but maybe a less direct sound because you've got more room sound in it. But my room at work is 20 by 30 by 11, and I've got a library area set right at the back of the room. So if I listen on my couch, I've got this great direct sound. I listen at the back, and it's a wonderful sound, and I can just relax and listen. Because the sound character, the tonality is all there, okay. And the imaging, it just, you trade a bit of directness.
Okay.
So, you know, when you get a concentric driver working, it has very good directional characteristics. And with a 10-inch, because it's controlling the directivity down to a lower frequency, it's even better, paradoxically, than using a small diameter concentric. So it's worked.
Okay, well, let's hear.
Could I ask one question before you start the music? I apologize, I was here with Swago. Yeah, I'm a solid state guy, sorry. So how much of it is the interaction in your personal opinions of what you want your speakers to sound like?
So
you know where I'm going with that question.
One thing I made sure is this speaker is efficient. It's like a real 91 dB.
Okay.
And a real 8 ohms, so it's minimum 6.4, but only over a narrow range. The rest of the range is above 8 or 10 ohms.
Okay.
So it's very compatible with tube amplifiers, because the biggest problem you have with matching tube amplifiers compared to a solid state is the frequency response that you get is dependent on the interaction between the source impedance of the amplifier, which is always very high, nearly every, especially low power tube amp, and the speaker impedance. So not only are you getting the innate character of that tube amplifier, but you're getting a variation in frequency response. I'm working hard to get the frequency response I want, and then we put one of those amplifiers on and I can get 2 dB variations in there. But once you keep that impedance level up high, then you minimize that.
Okay.
So it makes it much more compact.
All right, well, yeah. So you're saying they're going to sound just as well with solid state as they are.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I always use solid state amplifier for development work because I don't want that oddity.
Well, the majority of people would at least
Thank you very much. All right. Let's just close this door.
Yeah. cross town. I wanna know, yes, what makes me such a fool for you.
With the recording technology.
That's a good question.
Okay, so I'm going to stay vintage, and next I'm going to do Count Basie and Bluesville from 88 Basie Street. Thank you. dynamics and another great recording. So now I'm going to play around some different stuff. First, female vocal track. This is Friend and Fellow. What a Wonderful World. Yuri Honing Trio, Walking on the Moon.
Ah.
Good old favorite, yes. Yeah.
Personal life out of the room, but it's okay.
Yeah.
It's all right.
We're not allowed to use those words now. Okay, now for more bass dynamics.
That was pretty dynamic.
Yeah.
Now, are you using Cobas, Rune?
Everything's Cobas.
But is it through Rune or just from the Cobas?
Through the
Okay, so it's Rose, okay, so it's a Kovaz
stream.
Yes. All right.
Which is why
I didn't know if it was a Rune endpoint or.
No. Okay. That's why we're all using our cell phones, because you can't plug in anywhere.
I just wanted to make sure. Yeah. Yeah. There's.
I want words with David. Don't encourage us to use Kovaz and go to a hotel that doesn't have the service for it. I had to call T-Mobile and book my gigabytes my hotspot just for the show.
What was that track you just played?
Yuri Honing Trio.
Walking on the Moon.
Steam
did it too. I mean, his version sounds good.
Yeah. And since he wrote it, he kind of gets some credit.
So now, Marion Hill differently.
I know the story, I know it well. Know how much you miss him, I can see how far you fell. I know about her, I know she's new. But try to see it from a different point of view.
Stay true to doing value for money. Just because it's a more expensive point, it can still be good value for money. So with the right engineering and sourcing, but still applying a standard margins, it's not like we think, oh, it sounds good, let's just jack up the price or anything. Otherwise, when you play those games, what do you do for the next better one?
Yeah.
Where's right, that yeah. going to have to yeah. be? Yeah. It's like when I did that $100 Pioneer
speed. 99, you knocked me out of the park with that, dude.
People are going, yeah, but you just... You're not making money on it, you're just buying the market. I'm going, so let's play this out.
Yeah.
If I have no margin on that one, just to buy the market, what do I do for my next improved model?
Am I going to
continue never making money? Yeah. Or is it suddenly going to have to make money and now it's two or three times the price because I screwed myself up on the first one?
How important are the wall boundaries to where you place this particular speaker? Because obviously some speakers... rely a lot on the front wall here and the side walls. And obviously you have limitations if you're in a certain sized room in here.
Exactly.
It's a little...
I mean, my listening room is 20 by 30 by 11, so
right.
I've got plenty of space. Here, it's kind of a shoebox. But it's worked surprisingly well. One of the things that, being that concentric and a very good dispersion characteristic, is room sound is pretty uniform, yeah. right? So well balanced with the direct. So that helps. And then as far as bass is concerned, yeah, it's vented out the back, so you have to be careful.
You can't get too close.
You can't get too close.
You need to be 2-3 feet,
yeah.
4 feet.
But it's such a big speaker. Who's going to put that on a credenza or something? And yeah. certainly not a bookshelf.
Or certainly not a bookshelf, yeah.
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 I know, one more track. So
one more, okay, sir.
So
settle down, Joe.
Wait your turn.
So when I did the ELAC, debut speakers. I used to play this track, Deadmouse, the Sea,
yeah,
to show what it could do. You know, how good can a small box be at producing good bass?
Yeah,
and everyone would walk out and go, "Well, I didn't expect that."
Yeah,
right.
Was it Sia the track?
Sia.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that was a small driver.
Yeah,
that wasn't bass. This is bass. So let's. Show you what the 10-inch can do. I hate remote controls often.
It'd be nice if there was just a mute button that you could, instead of having to run the volume up and down.
There might be. You think I could read that?
I would say take advantage of the extra lighting over there. I totally understand that.
All the jokes we used to make about our parents. Oh, we're now those we're them. People.
Yeah.
It sucks.
Dinner last night, I was saying my mother used to say, I just can't eat as much as I used to. Now I know what she means. I have this. Okay. I didn't know that was good. Yeah. Okay.
You've already digested your breakfast.
If not, this will help. Serious SPL too.
Yeah. That was
I'm just gonna make up. I feel like a Tesla walking around with this.
I can feel the room moving there a little bit. Yeah. And that's hard to do in this room.
I mean, there was concussive air movement in the room.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, a lot of this is to do with he's a 10-inch driver, but you've got to drive it linearly.
Yeah.
And one of the issues in designing the motor structure, when I'm trying to do a 10-inch cone, and trying to control where the cone resonances are, it's just I'm trying to get them beyond my crossover point.
Yeah.
But you know, there's limits as how far beyond. But you can always say, okay, I just use a steep crossover and I'll cut all of that off. But that's not enough, because in a practical drive unit, it's not a linear system. In a linear system, it wouldn't matter whether you put the filter before or after something. But in a non-linear system, it does. So let's take an example. Suppose the cone resonance is at 4K, my crossover point is about 2K, and I put a steep slope on. Nothing above 2K gets through. Suppose I put a 2K tone in, and the motor structure has got distortion. The second harmonic
is 4K.
Is after the crossover. It's 4K, directly hits that cone resonance. And if the cone resonance is quite peaky, it magnifies the percentage distortion. And you hear that. So you've got to take care of the non-linearities as well. And one of the things everyone's been looking at recently, well, not just recently, but there's been a lot like purifying drivers, is how to reduce these harmonic and bits. More importantly, the intermodulation distortion is that we hear in the mid-range more. So it's down to magnet structures. Well, since I was designing this to have both the tweeter magnet and the woofer magnet inside the voice coil, normally you don't have enough area to get really good flux densities in the tweeter particularly. So I found a way. I know there's always, when you've introduced the tweeter down on top of the pole piece from the days of the Kef Uniq, you get some interaction between the two drivers. So the tweeter sensitivity measured outside of the magnet structure is not the same as measured inside. So maybe I can make use of that. So I started investigating all sorts of different topologies and ended up with one where reverse polarized magnets stacked on top of each other, they each feed all that stray flux that would be lost into each other and increase each other's flux density. So we call it twin drive.
Interesting.
That's partly because I'm a twin, so it's cool. But at the same time, the way it all stacks up, it cancels out these intermodulation distortions, which is the result of the voice coil flux driving the magnet and forcing it to change its operating condition. So the static field is no longer static. So if the static field is now varying and the current field is now varying, get distortion. Well, now this cancels out, and there's also copper in the gap and all sorts of things. So very low intermodulation distortion. And I think that's part of the factor why this has got that great resolution. You can hear all these things going on. And you can play loud, and it just keeps going.
Yeah. This is the most impressive product, personally, I've heard of this ship. I'm not kidding you. And anything that I've heard that's close costs 20 times as much. No shit. I'm serious.
Thank you.
Very impressive.
You're recording that, right?
Yes.
Send me that. I don't know what everybody else thinks. Yeah. But
no, it's a very impressive demo.
Extremely impressed with this product. So are you going to build, you have something in the back that you're working on, the next size up, or that's... can't say, or?
Well, I would be retired if I hadn't.
Okay.
Take the money for these and run.
Probably, I don't remember a product at this price point ever. And I mean, I've been an audiophile for over 40 years.
Looks like
and,
it.
And I have.
Oh,
wow.
I've been one for over 50.
We all have been people the same age.
I've been one for over 50.
I'm very fortunate. I have a six-figure speaker. I use Chroma Electors. And they are phenomenal. And I mean, I have the VAC stack.
Yeah.
So I have the 450 IQs. And, you know, it's really good. But this is very impressive. I mean, think about the cost differential. Yeah, I know you did.
Yeah.
Yeah, the VAC stuff is phenomenal, but it's expensive. Okay. It's very expensive.
$310,000 for the three pieces.
That is correct. I have those three pieces. Yeah. I didn't buy them all new. I'm not sure it's worth it. Is any piece of stereo equipment worth $100,000?
No.
But it's pretty, pretty
so this is all less than the sales tax on your
yes.
But less than the freight.
Yeah.
You shit me? The crumbles come from Spain.
Yeah, Andrew, the ability, you know, the first thing I heard off axis over here in the corner was the microdynamic resolution. I mean, the things that these things do, they shouldn't be able to do that at $10,000, okay? I mean, I've heard speakers that are speakers, they're very expensive, but it's staggering. And then when you played that Sia, the impact, the room, there was concussive air movement through. I mean, it wasn't like just a smack in the face. It was a pressure moving through the room.
Well, that simulates scary. Being there, right?
Yeah.
I play that track all the time in my room. Yeah. Okay, I do play that track a lot. I can sit in my listening chair and I can feel the pressure wave come down my hardwood floor. I can even see, like, I have a microfiber couch, a chair, and I can sit there and I can kind of feel it vibrating. So, I mean, and I think this would do the same thing, even in a big room.
And wonderful.
And the SPL that you had was, just a pair of tens. Well, not any. I'm just saying, normally a pair of tens a $2,000 pair of bookshelf or speakers that would come with, they could get close to half of that SPL, let alone that kind of speed and impact. So,
with 55 watts.
John, do you have a sheet of paper that has...
Doing this in home theater would be killer with that center matching.
Someone already came in and said...
Oh, is that right?
I'm looking to set up my home theater system. And
to match everything.
It's difficult to get everything matched.
Very difficult.
The dispersion, so you can sit anywhere, is very difficult. He says, I just found the solution.
This is it, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what people are overlooking. This is perfect for home theater.
Because home theater, we really... People do play loud.
Yeah, very loud.
You have a special... bracket for mounting on the ceiling.
Yeah. Great job.
Thank you.
Looking forward to having you down.
Yes.